Okay, so we'll continue further from where we left in the previous lecture. We've seen that in case of PCM, the maximum quantization error is delta by 2, where delta is your step size. It is the half of the step size. This is the maximum quantization error that a PCM system can have. All right. And we've also seen the reason behind it. Now, what will be the quantization noise power? So it is basically the power associated with the quantization noise. We need to find out the quantization noise power, which is associated with this quantization noise. So as we know that this quantization noise, it is undeterministic. This quantization noise is undeterministic in nature, so it can be treated as a random variable. Now, in order to find out the noise power of quantization noise NQ, that is, we want to find out the power of quantization noise. That means we have to find out the mean square value of this quantization error, or you can say expectation of QE square. This is what we need to find out. And if you simplify this expectation, mean square value of this expectation, it is integral QE square into PDF of QE. This is what we have to find out in order to find out the quantization noise power. Okay. So we need to have the knowledge of the PDF of quantization error. Okay. So let us try to first find out the PDF of quantization noise power. So following the assumption that has been made, assume QE satisfies uniform probability density function. We assume that this QE, the quantization noise, it is uniformly distributed between minus delta by 2 to delta by 2. We know the maximum value of steps, this quantization noise can be plus minus delta by 2. So we can say that it is uniformly distributed between this. This is the assumption that we are making. So in order to find out the PDF now, let's say this is some value x, right? So we know that the area under the PDF curve is unity. That is the property of a PDF curve. So area under this PDF curve is equal to unity. If you find out the area, it becomes this length is delta and this is your x. It's a rectangle, so x into delta is equal to 1. So x will be equal to 1 upon delta. So this is the PDF or this of the quantization error. So the PDF of the quantization error is 1 upon delta. Now let us make the substitution and find out the quantization noise error. NQ is equal to, now the integral range would be this PDF, it stretches between minus delta by 2 to delta by 2. So this limit of this integral, instead of taking minus infinity to infinity, it would be minus delta by 2 to delta by 2, because the PDF exists only in this range. So NQ would be minus delta by 2 to delta by 2 QE square into PDF, which is 1 upon delta dQE. Simplify it, 1 upon delta into QE cube by 3, and range will be minus delta by 2 to delta by 2. And if you simplify this, if you substitute the range, upper limit and the lower limit, and if you simplify it, the noise, quantization noise power, it comes out to be delta square by 12. This is the quantization noise power, very important expression, you should remember this. So this delta square by 12 is the quantization noise power, where delta is the step size. Now if we assume that the message signal is a sinusoidal signal, that is am cos 2 pi fm into t. And so if this mt is a sinusoidal signal, so what will be delta? Delta, we know step size, it is the dynamic range divided by the number of quantization levels, right? And dynamic range for a sinusoidal signal will be what? This is a sinusoidal signal, let's say. So this is the dynamic range, this is am, this is minus am. So the total dynamic range will be twice of am, right? So it becomes twice of am divided by l is the number of quantization level, and in terms of the number of bits, it can be 2 raised to power n, right? So this is the step size for the sinusoidal signal. Now if we substitute this value of step size in the quantization noise power nq, that is delta square by 12, if we substitute it over here, it becomes 1 upon 12 twice of am 2 raised to power n square, right? If you simplify it, so nq comes out to be 1 by 3 into am square by 2 raised to power 2n. This is the value of quantization noise power, an alternative representation of the quantization noise power. Now if you want to find out signal to quantization noise ratio, signal to quantization noise ratio, that is SQNR. This is the signal power, it's the ratio of signal power to the quantization noise power, right? So we've already derived quantization noise power, it is this for a sinusoidal signal, and the signal power for a sinusoidal signal is am square by 2, as simple as that. So SQNR can be written as am square by 2 divided by 1 by 3 am square divided by 2 raised to power 2n. This am square gets cancelled out, and if you simplify it further, it becomes 3 by 2 into 2 raised to power 2n. This is the signal to quantization noise ratio. Again, a very, very important expression. And it is a very important parameter. Signal to quantization noise ratio is a very, very important parameter for any PCM system, okay, where we convert analog signal to a digital signal. This gives us the ratio. So now this expression of signal to quantization noise ratio, which is really very important, it gives a lot of information. This SQNR is a very important parameter and should be as high as possible for a given communication system. Okay, so we can see that what are the factors that affect this SQNR ratio. N, that is the number of bits representing each quantization level, and if we increase N, we increase the number of levels, number of quantization levels, and this decreases the step size, right? And if decrease the step size, quantization error decreases. And we can say if the quantization error is decreasing, the quantization noise power also decreases, and thus results into SQNR increment. Okay, but this is the desirable scenario. But if increase N, that also increases the bandwidth. Bandwidth is directly proportional to N. We know that bandwidth of a PCM system is RB by 2. RB is the bit rate, which is equal to NFS by 2. So it is directly proportional to the bandwidth, and that is undesirable. So we need to have a trade-off between this number of level and the SQNR ratio that can be tolerated. Now what we can conclude from this SQNR expression, that is 3 by 2, raised to power 2n, as this n changes, if this n changes from, let's say, n to n plus k, if you increase the value of n by k quantity, SQNR, it increases by SQNR, it increases by 2 raised to power 2k times. This is one important conclusion we can make from this expression of SQNR. As this n increases from n to n plus k, SQNR increases by 2 raised to power 2k times, right? And if you find out this SQNR in dB, it becomes 10 log 10, this 3 by 2, 2 raised to power 2n, and if you simplify it, it becomes 10 log 3 by 2 plus 10 log 10, 2 raised to power 2n, right? This 10 log 3 by 2 is nothing but 1.8, approximately it is 1.8, plus if you simplify this, it becomes 6.02n. So this is the SQNR in dB. Another important expression to remember. SQNR in dB is 1.8 plus 6.02 n dB. Let's do an example based on this. A message signal given as 8 sine 8 pi into 10 to power 3t, this is the given message signal, is transmitted through PCM system, sampling rate is 50% higher than the Nyquist rate. Okay, and minimum SQNR for this system should be 22 dB. Now the question is to find transmission bandwidth, and second thing is SQNR in dB. You need to find out these two parameters. Let us try to solve this question. We are given with the message signal MT, that is 8 sine 8 pi into 10 to power 3 t, right? So we can say that AM, message amplitude, is your 8, and FM, message frequency, is 4 kilohertz, right? Nyquist rate is nothing but twice of FM, so it is 8 kilohertz. And the sampling frequency is given 50%, that the sampling rate is 50% higher than the Nyquist rate. We know the Nyquist rate, so sampling frequency will be 1.5 times of Nyquist rate. So it becomes 1.5 into 8, it becomes 12k. This is the sampling frequency, 12 kilohertz. Now we know that SQNR is 3 by 2 into 2 raised to power 2n in normal scale, and in dB, SQNR is equal to 1.8 plus 6n. We are given that for this particular system, the minimum value of SQNR should be 22 dBs, right? This should be the minimum value. So we can say that it should be greater than equal to 22 dB plus 6n. So from here we can find out the value of minimum value of n. So n should be greater than equal to, if we simplify it, it comes out to be 3.36, or approximately equal to, we can say, 4 bits. So n should be greater than equal to 4. That is one thing. Now since we have the information about n, that is the number of bits required to represent each level, so bandwidth would be equal to, we know that the expression of bandwidth is n into fs by 2, or you can say it is n into rb. Sorry, not n into rb, it's rb by 2, which is equivalent to nfs by 2. We know fs, we know n, so we can easily find out bandwidth from here. So bandwidth comes out to be 4 into 12 into 10 to power 3 by 2, it comes out to be 24 kilohertz. Right. And the second part of the question is to find out SQNR. So SQNR is equal to 1.8 plus 6 of n. We know the value of n is 4 into 4, so it becomes 25.8 dBs. This is the SQNR and this is the bandwidth for the for this required PCM system. Okay, now moving on, we'll discuss the next variant of PCM, that is DPCM. DPCM stands for differential PCM, differential pulse code modulation. Okay, now since we have the knowledge of PCM, we know that the quantization error, the maximum value of quantization error is delta by 2, half of the step size, right? This is an error and we need to reduce this error somehow. And the method to reduce the error is to reduce the step size. That is one method, and that will result into decrease of this error, right? And if you want to decrease this step size is nothing but a dynamic range, V max minus V min divided by 2 raised to power n. So in order to decrease the step size, to decrease the quantization error, we need to decrease this dynamic range. Okay. So in case of differential PCM, we will try to somehow reduce the dynamic range so that the step size is reduced and subsequently the quantization error is minimized. So in DPCM, aim is to reduce the dynamic range so that the quantization error is reduced. That is the concept. Okay. Now, what is the principle behind the DPCM? Okay. The principle behind DPCM is that whenever we sample a signal, suppose we have a sinusoidal signal and we sample it with a high sampling frequency. Okay, these are the all the possible samples. So we can clearly see that the difference between the two consecutive samples is not that much. So if we have the knowledge of one sample, let's say if we have knowledge of this sample, we can easily predict its consecutive sample, because the difference between the two samples is not very huge. If the sampling rate is high, obviously this distance, this difference will be even lesser, right? So, and in case of sampling, we know as per the sampling theorem, the sampling frequency should be at least twice of FM, right? So we are using a high sampling frequency. So the sample values are very nearby to each other, and more they are nearby or packed closer to each other, lesser will be the difference in the amplitude of the samples. So if we have knowledge of one sample, we can easily predict the other sample. This feature is being exploited in the case of DPCM, differential pulse code modulation type of a system. Let us have a look at the working of the transmitter first. I'll first draw the block diagram of the DPCM transmitter. This is the message signal. It passes through a low pass filter and then we apply sampler, and then we apply a complicated circuitry as compared to PCM. We have a prediction filter, which is a important component of a DPCM, and after this quantizer we have our usual encoder, and then the resulting is DPCM signal. Okay, let's say this is empty signal passed through a low pass filter and sampler, and the resultant is, let's say, MNTS, right? This is the present sample. And this the output of prediction filter is the predicted value of the present sample, which is, let's say, M hat NTS. This is the predicted value. Predicted value of present sample. Right. And we find the difference between the two, which is the error in prediction. ENTS is the error, and this ENTS is now quantized. That is the main crux of this DPCM transmitter. In case of PCM, the input given to the quantizer was the original samples. Exactly, right? In case of PCM, we know the chain was LPF, low pass filter, then sampler, and then quantizer, and then encoder, right? So the original samples were quantized, and the dynamic range of samples were huge. You know that this was the dynamic range, this was the total dynamic range. But in case of DPCM, what we are doing is, instead of directly feeding the samples to the quantizer, we are taking the error between the sample, original sample, and the predicted value of the sample. This prediction filter predicts the value of the sampler from the previous knowledge of the sample, right? It predicts the present sample. Obviously, there will be a slight error, a small error, and that error, this ENTS, will be a small error, and now that is quantized. So the dynamic range of this error will be obviously very, very small as compared to the dynamic range of the original samples. So we are able to reduce the dynamic range so as to minimize the quantization error. Okay. Now let us understand the working of this DPCM transmitter once we are clear with the logic behind it. So this role of prediction filter is really very important. See, what it does is it analyzes the past behavior of the signal by analyzing past behavior of signal. It predicts the present sample value. Okay, it has a number of delay elements, and it has huge storage capacity, and has complex logical circuitry. Okay, so we know that this output, this ENTS, error in the prediction, this ENTS is the error in the prediction. This ENTS is equal to MNTS minus M hat NTS. This is the present sample, and this is the predicted value of it. Predicted value of present sample. Let's say this is equation number one, and this ENTS is the prediction error. Alright. Now this prediction filter, it is a very precise circuit, and obviously the dynamic range of this ENTS is very, very small, so corresponding quantization error will be obviously small, right? So this quantization error QNTS, let's say this is the quantization error, will be equal to ENTS minus EQ. This quantization error QNTS is now nothing but this ENTS, which is the sampled value, and this is the quantized value. So this is the error, right? Let's say this is equation number 2. So see, at the input of quantizer we have ENTS. This is the original sample for this quantizer, and the output of quantizer will be EQNTS. This is the output of quantizer, right? So the quantization error would be this minus this, right? So quantization error will be this ENTS minus EQNTS. Let us name it as equation number 2. Now input of the prediction filter. Prediction filter input. This is equal to m hat NTS plus EQ NTS. You can verify it from this block diagram. Input of the prediction filter, this is equal to M hat NTS coming from this branch, okay, plus EQ NTS, right? Now if you substitute, if you use equation 2 in this, if you use equation 2, we have this EQ NTS equal to E NTS minus Q NTS, right? From equation 2 we can say that, from equation 2. Now if we substitute this value of EQ NTS here, the input to the prediction filter becomes, it becomes M hat NTS plus E NTS minus Q NTS, right? Now if we use equation number 1, equation number 1 is this, right? If we use equation number 1, this can be simplified as, if we use equation number 1 and substitute this M hat NTS from this in this equation, we get M NTS minus Q NTS using equation 1. Right? And we know the relationship that sampled value minus quantized value is equal to quantization error. This is the simple basic relationship, right? So we can say that quantized value is equal to sampled value minus quantization error, right? Now if you look at this equation, input of prediction filter, this MNTS is the original sample value, right? And what about this QNTS? QNTS, we know it is the quantization error. This is the original sample value, this is the quantization error. Sampled value, quantization error. So this resultant will be equal to what? MQNTS. That is the quantized value of, this is nothing but quantized value of MNTS, isn't it? So, and this is the input of prediction filter. So all such quantized value will be now stored in the prediction filter, and by analyzing the previous quantized value of the given signal, all the quantized value will be stored, and by analyzing those previous values of quantized value, signal prediction takes place, and present sample of the given signal is predicted by the prediction filter. That is the concept of DPCM transmitter. On the similar note, we have DPCM receiver. I'll first draw the block diagram of it. We get DPCM signal as input. First block is decoder, obviously, and then we apply some DPCM related blocks. We have again a prediction filter here, m at nds. This eq nds is the input. Passes through low pass filter and is the output empty. So the input to this low pass filter is nothing but EQ NTS plus M hat NTS. If you remember, this is nothing but your quantized value. This is nothing but the predicted value. So if we add these two, obviously we are going to get the quantized signal, original quantized signal, right? We are adding quantized value to the predicted value. And this, when passed through low pass filter, will result into your original signal m of t. The DPCM signal receiver is quite simple as compared to the transmitter circuit. So in the reconstructed message signal, the finite amount of quantization error will be retained, obviously, which is very, very small as compared to the PCM transmission. So this is the overall concept of DPCM, in which we make use of this kind of a transmitter circuitry. And the logic behind the DPCM is that we are reducing the dynamic range. Instead of feeding the original samples to the quantizer, we are feeding the error between the original sample and the predicted value of the sample, which would be very small. So the dynamic range becomes less, and we can make use of such a prediction because we know that after sampling, the difference in the amplitude of the two adjacent sample is very nearby, and we can easily predict the consecutive sample with given with the knowledge of the previous sample. So that is all for this lecture. In the next lecture, we'll study about the further variants of PCM, which are delta modulation, adaptive delta modulation. Thank you.